All right, joining us now is a University of Virginia legend. He is one of the founding fathers of the Tony Bennett, we'll say the Tony Bennett era of Virginia basketball. I would say it's what, Tate? Malcolm Brogdon, Joe Harris, Justin Anderson, Akil Mitchell. Are those the four?
Parentes, maybe London Parentes.
Yeah, maybe throw Parentes in there. His name is Justin Anderson. Justin, I want to start here. Your alma mater won the 2019 national title. I just want to get your general thoughts on how this all played out. Your thoughts as like the guy who, as I said, you were one of the founding fathers. You built this program into its current state, and now they win the national title after you graduate. Was there any sort of resentment? Were you where did you watch the game? What were your feelings? Do you feel like you deserve a ring? Give us your just overall thoughts on Virginia winning the 2019 title.
Man, I mean, you just kind of brought back some of the memories of it. Obviously, paying homage to the guys before me, Mike Scott, Jontel Evans, Mustafa Farrakhan. Those guys really paved the way. They kind of had a slogan. They called it the TAY. It was the turnaround year. It was a young Malcolm on that team, a younger Akil, a really young Joe. So those guys really kind of they had a mission of turning it around. But I came in with the mindset of, like, this is where I'm from. This is my state. Like, they can turn it around, but I'm going to try to put us on the map. Mm-hmm. So we came in with that same goal. And as far as the 2019 team, who still reigning champions because of the coronavirus, those guys were incredible. Like, those guys are guys that I helped recruit. And so that was kind of sweet in itself. So I felt like I was a part of it in the sense of, like, I actually knew the guys. I knew their hearts. I knew they were really loyal, dedicated basketball players. And I think that means a lot in the NCAA world now, because you usually get guys that want to come in and make it all about themselves, and I want to go one and done and things. Like, these guys were guys who were, like, kind of dedicated to their process. They went 3 years. So, you know, it's a special connection with me and those guys with that as well, playing out. So I was there at the Final Four. Luckily, I was playing in Atlanta, and we were kind of towards the end. We were at the end of the season, and I don't want to use tanking, but you can with that where you want. But I had a really cool coach in Lloyd Pierce, who coached me in Philly, and I was here in Atlanta with him as well, as a first-year head coach. And he was like, Jay, you better be going to the – and I'll take you back. I didn't know how to ask how I could go to this game in Minneapolis. And we had breakfast before a game. I think we had to play Milwaukee. And he was like, yo, Jay, you better be going to the game tomorrow. And I was like, really? Like, I can go? And so he, like, gave me his the grace to go, and got to fly out there and be there for both Final Four games.
There were a lot of you guys there, right? A lot of the former players were in Minneapolis for the title game, at least, right?
Yeah, me, Malcolm, Joe, Devin Hall, and a few other guys that maybe not at the top of my head, but we were out there really strong.
Yeah, that's cool, man. That's cool that you guys, like, all I don't know. I don't need to explain to you the perception of what Virginia basketball was before the 2019 title happened, and for you guys to just all be that family and you know, stick behind each other even after the UMBC thing. And, like, I don't know. I feel like that was almost a blessing for Virginia basketball, is, like, all of the, like, the narrative of what Virginia basketball became. It's like everyone who was in the program or part of the program, it just made your circle that much tighter. And then to see you guys, like, all show up at the 2019 title game, because Tate and I were there too. We were sitting, we actually got our tickets in the Virginia section. We were probably sitting not that far from you guys. We started just pointing out, we saw Malcolm. I know I saw Devin Hall there too. And we just started pointing out all the guys that were there and just how cool it was that I'm not sure if every program would have that, but you guys seem to have that. That's one of the cooler things about Virginia, I think.
Yeah, it was super important for us because, like you said, we kind of saw what the groundwork that was kind of laid to get there. Mm-hmm. And that was our goal. You know, Mike Curtis, unbelievable strength coach. Obviously, TB, his name and his staff speak for themselves. But that was our motive. It's like, we're going to get Coach Curtis a new weight room. And the only way that he can get a new weight room is if we win a national championship, because it was the budget at that point. So hopefully they're working on his weight room now. But, you know, we kind of saw everything. We kind of envisioned it for ourselves. And it's kind of like, I don't want to downplay, but, like, parenting a little bit, right? Like,
you
kind of go and you do something, you know, you achieve something at a high level. ACC championship, we got the chance to be able to accomplish it. We were like, all right, we're going to go get this national championship. And we kind of fell short, but to have someone, your family member or, you know, your child or whatever, kind of come up and do it better than you, is like, there's a feeling that kind of can't be replaced. Mm-hmm. And we're super proud of those guys, man. And to this day, like, we continue, it's something that we all can just continue to talk about and bond over, hopefully for the next, for a lifetime.
How much did you guys pay attention to the outside noise, particularly in 2015 when I think 2014 was the breakthrough year for Virginia basketball when you guys won the ACC that year, right?
2014, yes. Yep.
Yeah. You won the ACC in 2014. That was kind of like the put Bennett Ball on the map. But 2015 was the year you guys like had high expectations. Of course, you have the finger injury, and we all know what happened there. But throughout that entire season, it was basically like you and Kentucky had two of the greatest defenses I've ever seen in all my years watching college basketball. Were basically you and Kentucky that same season. And a lot of the narrative around college basketball that year was how unwatchable it became. And a lot of it was your fault, Justin, you in particular. You and Malcolm Brogdon, that became like the narrative of college basketball was like you, Malcolm Brogdon, and Willie Cauley-Stein are ruining college basketball. Nobody can score on these guys. And then Virginia, just the perception of what Virginia basketball was kind of got out of control there. How much do you guys pay attention to that? Do you like revel in this? Or is it awesome to see that like you're driving all these people insane that they can't even watch? They feel like you guys are breaking basketball, or do you just block out all the noise and just focus on winning and that's pretty much it?
I mean, yeah. I mean, I remember, I think you put out an article, the Club Trillion article.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, right? It boosted our walk-ons. Crazy. I mean, like, Everything was just falling into place. Everybody felt a part of it, which first and foremost was dope. And I remember being in the apartments with my best friend. I lived with my best friend in college. And I remember, like, watching the news, and guys are just like, these guys are ruining basketball. Or you'll see an article on Twitter, these guys are ruining basketball. And at the time, we're just 21-year-old guys just trying to make it. Like, we're trying to change our family's lives. We're trying to change our own lives. And then not only that, we're at an institution that requires so much from you from a scholastic standpoint, right? Like, I'm still trying to finish my degree as we speak. And we're doing all of this. And for people to just constantly disrespect us when we're number one and we're behind a team in Kentucky, we're number two and we're behind a team in Kentucky who's number one. We're watching TV just like, please just lose. So these guys, obviously that team was full of talent. The fact that Devin Booker was coming off the bench for them tells you a lot. But it got to a point where we were just like, yo, like, let's see them. Like, let's figure out a way to make this thing happen. And we wish college basketball worked that way. Obviously, schedules didn't align the way that we needed them to. But at the same time, it's like, man, we're putting in all of this work. We're doing all of these lateral slides in practice, man. We're doing all of this defensive stuff in practice for people to just constantly disrespect us. And so we kind of took it personal. We put that chip on our shoulder, and we were like, all right, you're going to respect what we do. And now I think it's Rothstein, I believe is his name. He always tweets out Virginia basketball, a thing of beauty.
Yeah. Well, Rothstein is a little late to the party. I mean, if Tate and I can pat ourselves on the back here, Justin, we were very early adopters to the Bennett Ball. We loved what we saw. I'm glad you brought up the article. I didn't want to be the one to bring it up, but yes. As everyone was saying, you guys were breaking college basketball. I was like, this is actually amazing. Like, I love how Virginia plays. You guys played so well together, particularly like that 2015 year. That was, I don't know. It was just so fun to follow you guys all season. And then Tate and I just became so invested in Virginia as a program, and just, we wanted Tony to get validated so badly. And then it just kept not working out in March basically every year. So then that's part of the reason we were there at the title game, was like, and we sat in the Virginia section just because we're idiots that felt like we were somehow invested in this, even though there's really no rhyme or reason why we should have been so invested.
Yeah, I mean, it just all finally came to play, and we just started to, like I said, we use that as a chip on our shoulder, man. And we just started to finally realize, like, all right, the fact that they're even talking about us is great. I grew up in Virginia, so we were talking about Sean Singletary as an individual, but we weren't talking about Virginia as a program. You know, it's a situation now where we put a program on the map and we wanted to do it for each other. So it all makes sense. I wish we could get past Michigan State the 2 years in a row that they kind of handled us. But that was a great program, and you respect them for what they did. But, you know, it all worked out the way it was supposed to. And here we are, champions, 2019 champions. So it worked out.
You mentioned your development at Virginia. You're a 3-year guy. We're currently in the part of the college basketball calendar where transfers are the big thing, and everyone's talking about which program they're going to. And then it becomes like a larger discussion about transfer culture, and so many guys are transferring. You feel like a case where you're the argument for not transferring, where you show up at Virginia, you don't start right away, you end up starting at the end of your freshman year. Then your sophomore year, I think you came off the bench. So your playing time is like kind of a little bit all over the place. You're playing behind Joe Harris. He leaves. You said you retool your jump shot coming into your third year, and you turn into a first round pick. And it seems like you know, like that, that is what a lot of the college basketball coaches that roll their eyes at transfers, like, will point to a guy like you and be like, that is the model right there. So my question to you, Justin, is did transferring ever enter your mind when you're, you know, you're a sophomore and you're playing behind, you're coming off the bench and you know how good you are. Or was this, did you foresee this the entire way that you would just develop your game and stick it out like that?
Absolutely. It came across my mind. I remember my sophomore year, we got blasted by Tennessee, and we talked about this a little bit, Tate, on our podcast. And London Perrantes was the guard that we needed. And going into that season, we just kind of went off of what happened last year. And we knew Malcolm was working on his ball handling relentlessly. And we knew Malcolm wanted to try to show that he could be a point guard so he can help his stock. Because back then, Malcolm, to this day, Malcolm's a little bit eased up, but he's still as stressed out about being great. But back then, Malcolm was super locked in. I mean, he's probably the most locked in guy that I've ever been around. And every day he's working his handle because he's like, man, I got to prove I can play point if I want to make it. And so we were like, all right, well, this year is the year to prove it. You'll play the one, Joe will play the two, I'll be at the three. We got a big guard lineup. And we go to Tennessee, and they just show us how we're not ready to play that lineup at all. And London's just a freshman, and his Cali pace was perfect at the point guard position in our conference because he had some dogs on the wing that can kind of get after it. And so for me, I took that really offensive. I was like, here I am, kind of taking a chance on this university and taking a chance on this program to, you know, be from here and come here and try to boost it up after decommitting from Maryland. And Coach Williford, Jason Williford, was the coach that recruited me. And in that moment, he realized that my game kind of went on a decline a little bit because I started to be in my own head. I knew I could have been in a couple of other big time schools that I won't mention because obviously I'm Virginia through and through. And so my pops talked to me, and my pops is like, well, you know, there's this one team they're dying to have you. Like, they keep calling. They won a championship the year before. So if you know hoops, you know who they are. They were hungry. I'll give a hint. They were the hungry team. And so I was, you know what? Like, they're athletes. And then it just came across me. I was like, that's just not who I am. I'm not one that's going to run away from any type of competition. And I'm not one that's going to run away from any type of adversity. This is good for me. I haven't had to experience it at Montrose, you know, in anywhere in my playing career. So this is great for me. And so actually, I have it in here. Give me a second. This actually changed. This actually changed everything. Once I realized, like, it's the Sixth Man of the Year trophy in the ACC.
Wow. Nice. Right?
So it kind of all, once I realized, like, you know what, I'm going to do this, I became 2 feet in, and I just put myself in a position to say, I'm going to do whatever it takes for this team. And me and Anthony Gill actually were going through the same thing at that time. And we both just looked at each other like, yo, let's just be dogs off the bench and let's figure this thing out. Mm-hmm. And shortly after this award came, they called me one day and was like, yeah, you're a finalist. And hey, you just won. And I was like, okay, that was never my goal. But it was cool to be able to go through that and kind of have that experience. And it helped me because now I'm in the NBA, and the constant up and down and the constant, you have to be the 15th man one year and the seventh man another. Like, it, all of that stuff really helped me in my playing career. So to the guys who were just, you know, I'm going to transfer because I want to do me and this and that, that's just never been in my DNA.
Yeah, and I remember, Justin, the after you win that Sixth Man of the Year trophy, right, the summer going, Joe Harris leaves, he goes to the NBA, you're going to be the starter that's moving into the starting lineup, and Tony Bennett tells you that, Coach Bennett tells you that. And then there was a story, right, that you went to Chicago and you worked out with your cousin who was playing for the Bears at the time and worked with the trainer that was like Thabo Sevilocious trainer and all that sort of stuff. I can't remember the name of who it was, but I remember that story because you guys beat North Carolina in the Dean Dome in 2015, and I was at that game, and I was like, well, how did Justin Anderson get so good at shooting the basketball from the corner? What is going on here? I think you had like 7 assists in that game as well. And what was that summer like? And did Coach Bennett put that on you to go and do that, or did you do it on yourself? Because like you said, you're making that transition from the sixth man to a starter.
I went into the next season, and I knew Joe was leaving, so we knew that was an opportunity. But the first thing Coach Bennett said to me before I even committed as a first year was, nothing that you get here will be given. Like, you have to earn everything. And so when I knew Joe left, I knew we were going to be lacking shooting. And I've always been able to shoot the ball, and I always actually like to shoot the ball from beyond college range or NBA range. It was just a matter of consistency, and I had to figure out consistency at a younger stage in my life than a lot of people do. Because if I wasn't consistent in, you know, shooting the basketball and putting in work, I could have lost my spot again, potentially. And I didn't want to do that. I felt that already. So what I did was, my cousin, he plays in the NFL. He had a 12-year career, Super Bowl champion, Jermon Bushrod with the New Orleans Saints, finished with the Miami Dolphins. I got the chance to go out there and spend a summer with him, because two summers in a row now, I'm here at UVA. We've had some success, but I can't be on this campus again. Like, I'm from here. I've been in Virginia my whole life. I need to get away. And he was living in Chicago at the time, playing with the Bears. And it was just the discipline that he showed me with his wife and his kids, of waking up every day at the same time. Breakfast is prepared. We're going to go do our speed and agility and strength, and then we're going to go to the court. And I decided to work with Steve Pratt out of Chicago, is his name, who's a phenomenal shooting development coach. And so when I came back from Chicago, I spent maybe 3 or 4 weeks there. When I came back from Chicago, you know, you have the mandatory be back at this time. Everybody's getting the email schedule. I came back and I was in the gym doing my, before we play pickup, I was doing my routine. And I remember, Coach Bennett and Coach Williford kind of watching me from afar, and they were laughing. And I took offense to it. I personally took offense to it. I was like, all right, so you guys want me to kind of continue to develop my game, but this is funny to you. And, you know, it kind of pissed me off in the sense of like, all right, like, keep laughing. I'm going to prove to you guys that I did what I was supposed to do, and I came back better. And so Coach Bennett actually kind of started to like what I was doing. It was a lot of like Dirk Nowitzki-esque drills, where you're kind of lunging off to the side and you're form shooting, and you're doing all of these like hop forward spin. We saw it with Kevin Durant in pregame. Like, I'm doing a lot of those drills that Steve is phenomenal when it comes to teaching shooting the basketball. And so it started to work. And I remember Coach Williford came up to me, and I was like, what does Coach have to say? Because I realized, like, Coach Bennett wasn't on my case as much that year. I was like, what does Coach Bennett have to say about me shooting 45? I'm trying to beat his 45%. I'm trying to beat his record, his college basketball record. And he was like, you want a no slip? He was like, he told us not to say anything to you, just to let you keep going. So for the rest of the season, Coach Bennett kind of just let me go. He knew I wasn't taking shots to try to put myself in a different category than my teammates. I was going to take the good shots. And it was actually a pretty cool story about how that all worked out. And I think he actually started to adopt some of the stuff that they're still doing to this day.
Absolutely. Oh, that's great. So I want to talk about this, because you're part of what stood out to me in the 2015 team and made me fall in love with Virginia, beyond all the reasons we talked about, where I kind of just felt like I loved the style of play you guys had. But like, you and Malcolm Brogdon in particular were the two best players on the team in 2015. And you guys were both so likable. There was just something about you guys that, like, you didn't really, I don't know. There's just something that was very, very easy to cheer for you guys. You had great personalities, and you seemed to just be a great representatives of Virginia. But what was always fascinating to me was, you always seemed to have this edge to you, Justin, that, like, you were not afraid to mix it up, we'll say. And that has become true as you progressed in your career. And so what I wanted to do with you is basically this, Justin. You've been in a handful of, we'll call them altercations. And now that some time has passed and your emotions have calmed, I want to revisit some of these, and I want to get a breakdown of what happened. And now that you look back on it, how much you feel like you are to blame for what happened, if that makes sense. So basically what this came from is, my first trip to Charlottesville was for the Duke game, when Justice Winslow grabbed your leg and you stood over him like you're going to rip his head off, and then you helped him up, and that whole thing. And then I was going to look back on, I was trying to find that today as I was researching for everything, and I typed in like Justin Anderson altercation or something, and there were so many results that came up. And then I was thinking to myself, how does this happen? How does a guy like this, that is, you know, so mild-mannered in this interview that we're doing, get caught up in this? But then at the same time, Justice Winslow grabbing your leg is not your fault. So I wanted to go through each of these individual instances, and you explain what happened and how much was your fault now that we're looking back on it. So the Justice Winslow thing, what happened here? Did you instigate him in any way? Give us the rundown here.
Well, I guess I'll begin by saying, like, I think I got into like 8 too many altercations in my basketball playing career, but where I'm from and playing at the YMCA and playing at, we called it American Family Fitness, in another gym that we had, and boys and girls and all of that, you get into these types of things all the time, right? You're just hooping, somebody gets fouled too hard, you push, they push back. But like at the end of the day, you know the people. You know the people at the club, you know the people at, you know, the rec center, you know the people who are, you're playing against, the Justice Winslows and whoever else we're about to revisit. So it's more just heat in the moment. And sometimes I like to say, like, I blacked out, right? Like sometimes you like black out in a moment and then like reality sets back in. You have to understand that there are people watching that, you know, this obviously we're playing, like you said, 19-0, maybe number one in the country. Like there are people constantly watching and I can't go and be one person in the community and then show or exemplify something else out on the court. And so for me, it's like my parents raised both of my parents together and, you know, everything to this day. They raised me to be respectful, but at the same time, like, you defend yourself when the time is right. And so for me, it was like in that moment, absolutely, I wanted to rip his head off. In that moment, it's like, all right, Justin, like, why would you do that shit? Like, that's bullshit. Like, so you realize like, all right, you know what? So you're in Charlottesville, you're in JPJ, and you're just like, come on, man. Like, that's uncalled for. And afterwards, you have the conversation with each other. Like, oh, yeah, he's like, my fault, bro. Like, I'm like, it's a part of competition. But if, God, I couldn't imagine if where I would be right now if that situation panned out and I just start wailing out on him.
Yeah, yeah. Well, one of the funny. It's one of my favorite clips. Is just because you had the visceral reaction where you're just like, I'm going to kill this dude, and then you caught yourself in a split second. You're like, or you know what? Instead of that, what if I just helped him up? And it just like immediately went from like war to like, never mind. I'll let cooler heads prevail. All right, so that was the genesis of this idea. And then as I started investigating more, the other one that's kind of funny looking back on is the one from the preseason this year where Marcus Morris bounces the ball off of your forehead.
Wait, before you go into the Marcus Morris one.
Okay.
There's one that you're missing. The one that I was tripping on was Nene. That was and when I was
I have that on the list. We can do that one. Go to the Nene one. Yeah, you were boxing him out and your arms get tangled up. What happened there?
So I already knew he was a big dude, and I kind of wish I could see it again, but I just remember after the game, Darren Williams, who was my vet, great guy, like still talking to him to this day. I remember Darren was like, yo, you know, he's like black belt or whatever it is that he had. I was like, bro, I didn't know, nor did I care. Like, why are you're mad strong and you just like take my arm and lock me up? Like you could have broke my arm, bro. Like,
yeah.
And so in the moment, I was just a young kid. Like, I was just young, like, kind of hot-headed. And I was just like, come on, man. What's up with that? And then they, you know how NBA fights are, right? Like,
right.
You get separated or whatever. But it's like, it's more of just an intense, heated conversation, you know, right in front of each other. But that one, I think that was the only one that I would say I was tripping, because that dude is a scary fellow.
As Jalen Rose says, hold me back, right? And that the thing,
right.
Hold you me don't back. Actually fight, just hold me back. Right. Yeah, I had Nene on the list. All right, we'll save the Marcus Morris one for last. How about that? What about the Dwayne Wade one, where Dwayne Wade just inexplicably grabs your arm and throws you into the first row during the playoffs? What happened there? What's the story behind that?
Well, that was media. That was the media row, not the first row.
All right.
I'm a little heavier than that. But that was another situation where I saw him later. I actually ended up coaching his son in the NBA Top 100. And it was kind of awkward for a second. And I let my pride down and I was like, yo, what's up, bro? Like, how's everything? Whatever. And we kind of talked. But that was just playoff basketball. I remember Lloyd Pierce is our coach. He was our defensive coach in Philly. And he grabbed a hold of me and TJ McConnell. He talked to us both individually, but he told me, he was like, hey, I talked to TJ, and now I'm talking to you. We're going to need you both defensively to try to stop D. Wade in that second unit. He's like, I don't know which one of you guys I'm going to put on him, but keep in mind, I'm 13th man at this point, 12th, 13th man, and I'm trying to continue to put my stamp in the NBA and trying to keep my career on the up. And so he was like, look, do whatever you got to do. I need you to get in his head. I need you to lock him down. I need you to do whatever it takes to kind of keep him from killing us. Because when he's coming off the bench, that second unit, when they win the ball games based off of analytics. And so I kind of initiated that one. obviously, D-Wade is goated. He's one that I've always watched growing up. I initiated that one because when I first came into the game, I just like stared like right at it. It was kind of like Stevenson LeBron type stuff. But I just wanted to prove to my coaches, like, look, whatever you guys need me to do, I'm willing to do. And we ended up going on to win that series. But I think because I kind of initiated it by just touching him too much and like kind of bumping him, I was doing everything just to get under his wing. It was on a box out. I went to box him out with my forearm and he caught my forearm. And he showed me how strong he was in that instance. And then fast forward a few plays later, he comes down, he crossed me. I mean, these are all like internet memes that you never want to be a part of, but it's a part of the journey, I guess. And he crosses over and he misses the shot. So I was good. If he makes on top of all of that, it could have been social for sure.
But no, that's what you want though. If it, like that, him throwing you into the media, isn't that like validation that you're doing a good job? Like that's exactly what you're trying to do is frustrate him, right?
And yeah, with all due respect, obviously Hall of Famer, like
yeah,
one of the best shooting guards to ever even lace him up. But he wasn't able to do whatever he wanted. And if you know the season before that, I mean, he was killing guys, especially against us. I mean, he was hitting big time, like game winners against us in Philly. He was doing his thing against us. And so I'm sitting on the bench like, yo, all you have to do is this. And so now is my opportunity to go prove that.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter who you are. I can guard you.
Yeah. 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 All right. So I had a few others on my list. Let's see here. Carmelo Anthony, when you guys, it wasn't really an altercation. It was just, you guys were talking smack back and forth and it got heated and some guys had to come in and that was a hold me back for sure. Like no one really, it didn't really get physical, but, you guys were definitely jawing. What was the story there? This is in 2017, I believe.
Like I said, I think I got into 8 too many of these things.
I know. Well, that's what's hilarious to me is like I didn't realize that this was a thing with you until and what's funny about it is so many of them are it feels like they're not your fault. I mean, like you're just trying to block out Dwayne Wade and he just grabs your arm and throws you and Justice Winslow's grabbing your leg. And I'm like, I wanted to get to the bottom of this, Justin. Is this your fault? Are you just a pest? Do people hate Virginia style of basketball and they blame you for it? Like, what's going on here?
I think the biggest thing, right, is like nobody likes to be touched. Like, I was watching a Jordan documentary, and I think my pops was preparing me for that. He didn't kind of see the game changing to this, we're going to pull up 2 steps over half court. If you grab a guy and you throw your head back, it's an automatic foul. He didn't prepare me for that. I mean, I was playing against grown men ever since I was like 10 or 11 years old. Like I said, at rec centers, former pros, you know, I played 2 years up or 3 every year. Like I was a freshman playing 17s on Boo Williams with Kendall Marshall and James McAdoo and Travis McKay. These are Andre Dawkins. I mean, these are guys that were just bigger, stronger, faster than me. And I had to figure out how I can, you know, hold my own. And a guy like Melo, I mean, when he's in that 15-foot range, if you don't touch him a little bit, he's going to embarrass you. And, when I'm trying to carve out a career for myself and, you know, put food on my plate, my family, take care of everybody, like, I have to go out there and do whatever it takes to get stops. And that's one thing I think that a lot of teams and people respect me for is that I'm willing to guard whoever, point guards. Mm-hmm. But with the whole Melo thing, it was the same type of scenario. The one thing, it was kind of a running joke. I talked to Joel about it, and then we like joked about it for the rest of the season because he kept saying, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that. And it was like, how great do you have to be to just say 3 words and like and somebody's just like, all right, like you got it, but I'm not gonna, you know, make this, it's not gonna be easy for you. But it was just trash talk, man. It was just, you know, a lot of bumping. And we actually saw them later again at the end of the season. I think I had my career high against them, and it was just trash talk, man. I mean, that's what it was. And it was obviously no disrespect or anything. I have, once again, Hall of Famer, huge respect for Melo. Comes from the same area in that D.C., Maryland, Baltimore area. Huge amount of respect. But it's just competitive fire. And for me, every night is a playoff game. When you're 13th, like I said, 13th, 14th, 15th guy, you don't get time to just go out there and be cool and try to just, you know, try to play everything off like, oh, I'm just happy to be here. I mean, for me, I have to be a little gritty. And sometimes it gets me in a little bit of trouble.
All right, so the one I would say might be your fault, and you can disagree with me. It was the Russell Westbrook dancing in the playoffs where he was dancing with Cameron Payne.
And then
you and Villanueva like kind of walk in front of him, and you're trying to antagonize him, Justin.
Listen, it wasn't my fault. The day before we were in the playoffs as a rookie with Dallas, Rick Carlisle, UVA legend, obviously Boston Celtics, 2011 NBA champion, loved my time in Dallas, loved Coach Carlisle, Mark Cuban, all those guys. The meeting before we played OKC, Coach is pissed because Cam Payne and Russ Westbrook do these dances before every game. And he's like, I'm just waiting for one of you suckers to just go out there and interrupt one of those dances. And Charlie Villanueva says, Coach, you know what? You're right. Me and Rook got it. I'm like, what? And so I'm with, because me and Charlie go, we do our handshakes with our own team. So yeah. Chopper's like, Rook, let's go. Like, I'm like, all right, bet. Like, whatever. So you see me just kind of jump in the middle of it. I get thrown back, and then the video, the meme video kind of cuts short. But I come back right back, and he does the same thing. Starts complaining to the referees. That was a funny one, man. That was real funny.
Yeah, you trying to play it off as though like you don't realize he's right there is so funny. It's so funny to rewatch. All right, okay, let's do the Marcus Morris one. We'll end on that one. What in the preseason this year, everyone's seen the clip. If you haven't, just go Google Justin Anderson Marcus
Morris.
No,
don't Google that shit.
It's objectively, Justin, I'm sorry that you fell victim to this, but it is objectively funny. It is something, in all my years of watching basketball, I've never in my life seen a guy just take a ball and just bop a guy in the face. So you really must have been pissing him off. Like, what the hell is the story here? I know you guys were like getting into it a little bit before that happened, but what?
No, we never got into it. Actually, it was interesting to me. What was really weird to me is, keep in mind, like, I'm trying to make a team, and I'm not going to make an excuse for anything that happened. But at the same time, like, what happened happened, and it is what it is, right? And so before the game, I'm trying to make the team, and I'm not sure. I'm asking Brad, like, yo, like, what do you think they're going to do? Like, whatever. So he's just like, just keep killing. You've been killing in training camp. John Wall saying the same thing. And, you know, just keep going out there killing. So we play these guys. We play New York. And they're on this, like, tough guy thing already, right? You remember Bobby Portis kind of talking about some of that stuff earlier in the season. And so before the game, I was like – I say to him, and I started that game, and my matchup was the Morris twin. And so we started the game, and he's like, I'm like, let's go. Good luck this year, whatever. Stay healthy. And he's like, you too, young fella. Keep going. I see you. And so I'm like, all right, cool. Like, you know, and I didn't think anything of it, whatever. So at the time, he wanted to prove himself of being like a scorer for them. And if you watch the first half of that game, he got ejected, obviously, in the second at the end of the first half. But if you watch that, like, I made everything tough on him. I made it very difficult. And then I come out of the game, and he just goes on this tear. Somebody else is guarding him. He goes on a tear. He's hitting fadeaway threes. He's hitting turnaround post-ups. The only 2 points that he scores on me, which was I thought was a bad call. He gets to the cup. I foul him, and he gets an and one. He goes through my body, and I believe he gets the and one. Mm-hmm. And nothing, no trash talk or anything is said, but he bumps me. And so we come back. I'm like, all right, whatever. Like, that's just a part of what it is, right? So then we come back out. And I was like, come on, like, why you do that? Like, we not doing that. He like, we not doing what? And I'm like, what? Like, what just happened to you? Why are you so?
You're like, where's Charlie Villanueva?
No, I didn't need any backup, right? Because I'm not thinking that somebody eventually will go on to just taking the ball. Like, the only time you do that is if you're crossing up and you go off the heezy, right? Old school.
Yeah.
So when it happened, first I would say, I pressure up because I'm not – he's already at 17. He had a great first half, not against me, but I'm going back in to do what my job is. So I pressure up, and he throws the elbow. And I look at Ed Malloy. I'm like, yo, Ed, like, that was this close. That was a fingernail closer, just taking my whole nose off. Keep in mind, this is the most random – we're not doing that. We're not doing what? Like – there's no if it was trash talk, I don't care.
Also, we should say it's preseason. That matters too. It's like
it's preseason. And so you know, as soon as the elbow, I look at Ed, I'm like, yo, Ed, what's going on? And by the time I look back in, I'm getting hit in the head with the ball. And like, I don't even know what to make of it. And like, of course, like, look, after the fact, like, everybody has Twitter fingers. I come back into the locker room, Bleacher Report's blasting it. And I get it. That I will say there was a moment where I was really embarrassed and I wish I would have done something about it in the moment. But then I look back at it and it was just – and a bunch of guys around the league hit me up and was like, yo, you handled that the way that you were supposed to. That was bullshit or whatever.
Yeah, sure.
And that's what kind of made me realize, like, all right, cool, whatever. But it was like – for me, I was like, where did that even come from? I don't even understand. Like, it's never been any whatever. And so when I get hit, I don't even know how to process it. And so – You guys have seen He Got Game, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, of course.
So if I could go back, remember when Denzel just like right in the throat Lala's boyfriend? I forget who it was, but the guy that was talking to him, like, you start playing all of these things, like, man, what should I have done to him? So it wasn't a situation where I was gonna have it.
That's what you were gonna go for.
Hit again.
The MacGruber throat rip, that's what you're going to go for?
Just quick, right?
Yeah.
Okay. But, you know, I mean, that's when you kind of look back at
like
it.
That.
You kind of look back on it and you say, like, you know what, it is what it is. I'm glad that, you know, where I want to be in life, once again with the Justice Winslow thing and all the other stuff, it's just trash talk. Like, where you want to be is so much further than being remembered. Like Chris Childs and Kobe Bryant. Like,
right.
Chris Childs had one of the best two pieces on Kobe Bryant. But it's like, that's not what I'm here for. Like, I have dreams and aspirations that go far beyond being just an NBA basketball player. Like, I want to be able to get into broadcasting and do things at the highest level. So, like, that's a part of just who I am. I'm kind of forward thinking, and that's not the message that I wanted to send to other people. But the worst part about it is that, like, it comes across as like, yo, this dude is sweet. We're just going
to that's what's just so wild to me is that you're obviously a nice guy, off the court at least. You don't have a reputation, as far as I know, as like being a dirty player. It's not like you're giving these guys cheap shots and they're retaliating. You're just kind of an antagonist, and you just play good defense is what it seems like. But it's just funny looking back when you kind of stack them on top of each other. It's like, is this dude just that unlucky that like guys just snap and just start throwing him around and want to fight him? Or is he doing something? That's why I had to ask, Justin. I just had to ask how much is a...
No, it's actually great because I never really talked about it. Like, I refuse to go on Twitter and be like, yeah, bro, see me after, like, whatever.
Yeah.
I refuse to be that guy. Like, when the moment comes and we speak face-to-face, then that's what it is. But as far as, like, trying to make it a big old public thing because I was the one that kind of was the victim, if you will, like, that's not really who I am. Like, it's just – it is what it is. It happened. It's gonna it's our media today, right? It's gonna recycle, and you just gotta kind of deal with it.
And it's really like you as you know, these things happen these things happen in practice all the time. As you said, you're growing up playing against guys older than you. I'm sure there's a ton of like, this is not, it's not like there's the, I don't know, any cause for concern that guys playing basketball will get into it every so often. Like, that's a normal thing that happens on basketball courts. But anyway, I don't know. I thought it was pretty funny.
No, they are. They're hilarious to me. When someone put together the compilation of me getting into it with everybody, I was like, all right, like, I gotta chill. Like,
yeah.
But I mean, if that's what comes with locking people up, then you know.
That's a good thing. Yeah, that's a good thing.
Yeah, you're gonna spin the narrative and say that you would have been a great '90s basketball player and just pander to that era. You know what I mean? Start talking to the Charles Barkleys of the world, the Shaquille O'Neals of the world. Start sending them tapes of you playing hard defense. You know what I mean? That's the next move.
Can you give us any insight into Tony Bennett that the people don't know? Is there anything that Tony Bennett does that does not fit with his image? That does not align with his image? Does he have a back tattoo? Does he ride a motorcycle? Is there anything that Tony Bennett, like, people be like, wow, I didn't see, does he smoke cigarettes? Is he a chain smoker? Like, is there anything that, like, or is he really just as, like, straight-laced as we see on TV?
Well, if there were off the top, I probably wouldn't even share it with you guys.
Yeah, that you'd be in trouble if you did.
I don't know if I'll get in trouble, but that's just family, right? He's like a father figure to not only me, but all of us. You know, I mean, he's just as solid as they come, man. And he's a great example through religion, through his faith, through competitive spirit. Like, he always would talk about how, you know, Jesus was this great man. But at the same time, Jesus was no walkover, right? Like, he would come back and he would, you know, he would show fight when the time was right and everything. But he's just a great dude. He's super competitive. Like, he plays ping pong and he tries to take your throat out in ping pong. He shooting competition, he's trying to kill you.
Anything. Is he a good trash talker?
Yes, because really? because you don't expect it, though. Not because it's like he's gonna get a whole gym behind him and everybody's like, oh, he's talking crazy today. No, it's like he'll get into a competition with you and he would let his game do it. And then once he starts wearing you out and your tongue's hanging out, then that's when he just starts saying things like, well, what's up? Like, you can't. And so he'll wear you out, you know, kind of like that. But he's just sly, man. He's a smooth guy. Like, he, you know, everybody wants to be like TB nowadays, right? He's the trending topic.
Well, Tate, we got anything else for him? Is that it?
No, I was going to say, I appreciate you coming on, Justin. And for people that don't know, you guys have the podcast, right? Locker Room Access. And it's all the Virginia guys just rotating in and out, talking about Virginia basketball. So if you already enjoy Mark Titus and I talking and fawning over Virginia basketball, go listen to Justin and all these other guys actually talk about it.
Yeah, if you like us talking about Virginia basketball, you might like guys that actually know
it. The actual Virginia basketball. That would probably be good.
Justin, thank you so much for joining us. Continued success. Continue to antagonize people. Don't let me pointing this out say that you should stop. That was not the point of this. This was just a fun little exercise we're doing here. We love your brand of basketball. We always have, both Virginia and you individually. Thank you for joining us. Good luck with everything. We appreciate
it. Thank you. I appreciate it. Yeah, absolutely. I'm not initiating anything, but whatever happens, it kind of comes with the territory.
Right. For the best access, perspective, and personalities in all of sports, follow us at Fox Sports on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube.